Pennsylvania Game Commission is responsible for the state's wild birds and wild mammals. The Game Commission has successfully recovered several species, some by way of reintroduction. Our mission is to manage Pennsylvania's wild birds, wild mammals, and their habitats for current and future generations. There are currently 29 state-threatened and endangered species. 9 are mammals, and 20 are birds. Join us on our journey, a path fueled by passion and persistence, sometimes riddled with heartache. But often, joy is the fruit of our success as we learn from our never-ending teacher that is our natural world.
Any population that's colonial, and by colonial what I mean is that they nest in colonies, are more susceptible to some sort of nesting disturbance. With all the birds concentrated in one area, if something happens there, then there could be total nest failure for the year.
Wade Island is unique. It's one of only two places where great egrets are still nesting, and it's the only place in the state where double-crested cormorants are nesting.
Even though Wade Island is on the edge of the breeding range of the species, it's the core of the range of the species in Pennsylvania. So if we want them to persist in the state, we need to make sure they persist on Wade Island.
For the Wade Island survey, we're going to spread out across the island, forming a single line, and count all of the colony nesting birds that are here on the island. And by all the birds, what I really mean is we're going to count the nests of each of those birds. The idea of staying in a line is simply to minimize the disturbance to the colony. We try to only spend the maximum of 2 hours in the colony a year to minimize disturbance and maximize the colony's ability to raise young and replace itself. We're primarily going to see great egrets, black-crowned night herons, and double-crested cormorants. There is the off chance we might come across a yellow-crowned night heron, but that's only happened on rare occasions here at Wade Island. So wading birds, the distinctive characteristics are a long neck, often carried in an S shape while they're flying, long legs, and compact bodies. They have a long dagger-shaped bill relative to the size of their head.
And most of them are colony nesters. The only exception we have here in Pennsylvania is the green or green-backed heron, which is a solitary nesting heron.
We've been conducting the survey here at Wade Island for several years. We have data back through 1985. Populations are not typically static. They have good years and bad years. And with the birds in so few sites in the state, for the persistence of the bird in Pennsylvania, it's critical how well they do at those sites.
Careful monitoring of colonies, especially those colonies that we only have one or two of in the state, are critically important to maintaining the population in Pennsylvania.
Great egrets start nesting when they're 2 to 3 years old. The breeding plumes have a distinctive shape. They're much more open. They're lacier looking than their regular plumes, and they extend out the back. When they display to each other, they tend to stand those plumes up. These feathers are really quite striking. And that's part of the downfall for great egrets. Exaggerated hats were all the rage. They were a fashion statement, and these breeding plumes became an important component of those hats. The pressure was such that entire colonies were lost. The populations were decimated by the feather collectors, and it's part of that loss of these great numbers of birds that helped the public recognize that they were losing an important part of their natural world for a fashion trend. The loss of the birds through the feather trade brought the recognition that it was not a limitless resource and eventually brought about the protection of the birds. And some of these like-minded people came together and formed organizations like the Audubon Society. And through their efforts, legislation was passed, such as the Endangered Species Act, and these species were protected. As a result of a lot of hard work on many people's parts, several of these species have been recovering now for decades. That's part of the reason we get to enjoy great egrets in Pennsylvania now. And even though they are in low numbers, we are reaping the rewards of the commitment that people made many years ago. For nesting season, great egrets are monogamous. One male and one female pair, build a nest, and raise young. They share all those duties. They share incubation, taking turns. They both feed the young and protect the young. Great egrets tend to nest in the tops of trees. Those nests are fairly distinctive looking. They're a loose twig structure, but they're very large. They can be up to 3 feet across and a foot deep. When you look up at them from underneath, you can actually see sky through some of the twigs. They're sturdier than they look because usually they stay in the trees and the chicks and eggs don't fall out. The male and female both will take turns and incubate for 23 to 27 days. They can have anywhere from 1 to 6 eggs, but typically it's 3 to 4. So even though the bulk of courtship occurs as the pair bond is forming and as the birds are building their nest, you can continue to see courtship when the adults exchange incubation duties. The male will come in, he'll display to the female. She may do a little bit of displaying back, or she may be kind of anxious to get off the nest and just take off, but then the male will take over the incubation duties and settle on those eggs and protect them. So they're trading off incubation duties throughout the course of the day. And that does several things. It relieves the bird that's incubating to take care of themselves, to go out and forage on their own, to preen and get their feathers back where they belong, to stretch wing muscles, just to take care of themselves. So it's important that they trade off those duties. In an egret nest, the eggs don't hatch all at one time. Great egrets are altricial. That means when they hatch, they are naked, not very developed. They grow very rapidly, but they depend completely on the adults to bring them food and feed them. Those young will stay in the nest for 21 to 25 days, and they are asynchronous, so there's older chicks in the nest and there's younger chicks in the nest. They're aggressive from the time they hatch, so if the adults are bringing plenty of food, sometimes the birds can raise all those chicks. If they're not bringing in plenty of food, then the older chicks, being stronger and more coordinated, beat up on the younger chicks. And in fact, the activities associated with siblicides were first described in egrets. If there's a shortage of food, the older chicks are going to do whatever they have to try to survive. So many people are familiar with the Federal Endangered Species Act. Species like bald eagles and peregrine falcons were on the list since its inception, and it's only with the recovery of the population that they've been removed. In addition to federal listing, which is more of what the species is doing as a whole, many states, including Pennsylvania, have state-listed species. And those species might be doing well in other places, but their population is more precarious within the bounds of our state. We only have a couple of places, and Wade Island here is one of those, where they nest in the state. And if we want to keep them as a breeding bird, then we need to protect them here in these sites. That said, part of the reason that the numbers are probably low here in Pennsylvania is that we're really on the edge of their breeding range.
It's important to understand mortality, habitat, and competition issues, especially on the edges of the range. And that's because it helps us form management guidance for the core of the range. If we allow the range of any species to shrink, not only do we lose them on the edges of their range, you're making the entire population more vulnerable.
So Wade Island is unique. It's one of only two places where great egrets are still nesting, and it's the only place in the state where double-crested cormorants are nesting. Part of being a colonial bird means that there are often a lot of other birds breeding near you. And in the case of great egrets, they're noisy, loud birds. What that means is that the colony is very noisy. As the season progresses and young start hatching, there's even more noise because all those chicks are now begging for food from their parents. So there's this cacophony of sounds. It can be sort of deafening. They're eating aquatic critters. It smells a lot like low tide. So, like, all your senses are being overloaded by being in the colony, and it's a really strange and overwhelming sensation. After they're done breeding, late July or so, they spread out across the state. So if something catastrophic happened on Wade Island, the chances of you seeing great egrets across the state in the later portions of the summer would be much less likely. With all the birds concentrated in one area, if something happens there, then you could have total nest failure for a year. It could be something man-made, like an oil spill or fireworks at the wrong time of year, or removing trees when the birds are nesting. It could also be something natural. It could be a disease, like this year AI is running rampant, and if you happen to end up with AI in the colony, you might lose all the birds. And it's shocking. Even now, our numbers are probably not what they were. Even though the birds are coming back, and they're doing relatively well, they can't come back to what they were because we've destroyed all kinds of habitat.
It's estimated that Pennsylvania lost 28,000 acres of wetlands over a 23-year period from 1956 to 79. That's an average of 1,200 acres a year.
In general, conservation continues to be depressing. We don't typically protect things until we've lost them or we are rapidly losing them. The feather trade and the dramatic decline of egrets is a great example of that. The loss of bald eagles is another great example. They were basically considered vermin, even though they were our national symbol, until they were almost gone. And then people went, wait a minute, we actually place value in these, and maybe we should do something before they disappear. You have to be optimistic. You have to see the possibilities, even though you're fighting a huge uphill battle. And until the delisting of bald eagles, for example, we had very few conservation successes that we could point to, things that had gone really well. But we do have a few of those now. We see the ability of species to come back if we eliminate the problems that cause these dramatic declines, especially when they're human driven, and most of them are. Most of them are direct persecution, habitat loss, toxins introduced into the environment. They are things, even if they were unintended consequences, they are things that we human beings did that changed the natural environment so that it was inhospitable. And when we take those responsibilities seriously, we change the discussion. And if we use the past as an example, when all of these horrible things were happening, we were losing all these species, bald eagles were all but gone. We passed the Endangered Species Act, we passed the Clean Water Act, we passed the Clean Air Act. We didn't necessarily pass all of those, for example, for eagles, but they addressed the problems we had created that the eagles were being affected by. And so that allowed the populations to respond. Sometimes we're a bit removed from the wild around us. We don't realize that our actions can have direct consequences for the ecosystem itself and individual critters. There's a lot of things people can do to help, things you might not have thought of. Limit the use of lawn fertilizer and chemicals, the things that wash into the waterways and cause all sorts of problems downstream. Making sure that you leave a buffer around waterways so that any sort of runoff isn't contaminated by herbicides or pesticides. Leaving riparian buffers along the streams to help minimize erosion, stabilize that stream bank, and again, help slow down any sort of runoff that might be into that water. Clean up fishing line. I can't tell you the number of times I've seen birds tangled in fishing line. They can drown from it. They can get it wrapped around in a way that they can't forage, and so they actually starve to death over time. Use lead-free tackle. That's a direct way to keep lead out of the streams, and we all know no level of lead is safe. We should all remember that higher water quality leads to more abundant food resources for the bigger, showier animals that we enjoy watching. It leads directly to higher chick survival, as well as species recovering more rapidly from any sort of catastrophic event. No matter what we do, there will be catastrophic events. Imagine those severe storms. We can't stop those. But if the population's healthy when those events happen, then the population as a whole can rebound from those much more quickly. Conserving great egrets of Pennsylvania is important for their intrinsic value. They're a critical component in a healthy ecosystem. It would be a much poorer ecosystem without great egrets and other colony nesting water birds in it.